Tonight our subject is entitled Daniel 2 and the Second Coming of Christ. Before we begin, though, I would like to invite you to kneel where possible or bow your heads as we ask God's blessing. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the privilege of opening your word together tonight and seeking you to understand more about the way you have worked in history, your guiding among the children of men. And we ask, Father, that you will bless us with your Holy Spirit that we might certainly understand and have clarity of thought. Give your servant tonight the very words that he needs. Help him to understand his role and what he must do. We ask, Father, that you will touch each one who is here. May your angels draw near to be with us too, Father. And for those who are still traveling, we know there are some who are coming yet tonight that haven't arrived yet. And we pray that you will give them safety too. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. Well, I want to welcome you to this prophecy revival where Jesus is first and foremost in our cause. You might be wondering why we're looking at prophecy in connection with revival. Don't we usually think of Bible texts like John 3:16? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, what? Believeth in him should not perish, but what? Have everlasting life. Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Paul says, I'm not ashamed of what? The gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. To who? To everyone that believeth. That means you, doesn't it? It means you, brother, you, sister, you, brother, me, each one. It's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And he says, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. Paul says, I am crucified with Christ. Acts chapter 16 and verse 30. Sirs, what must I do to be saved? And that's a great question, isn't it? It's a question that there are many people are trying and struggling to understand tonight. Really, what does God expect from us? What is required for salvation? What must I do to be saved? What does prophecy have to do with all that? Well, I'd like to begin tonight by considering just a few Bible texts that consider two special books of the Bible. Now, the first one I want to look at is in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 15. Jesus, in this particular chapter, is especially speaking about some of the signs of the end times and his coming. And tonight we're talking about Daniel chapter 2 and the second coming of Jesus. And in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 15, Jesus says, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet stand in holy place, whosoever readeth, let him understand. And then in verse 16, he gives the counsel that they were to flee from Jerusalem and go into the mountains. And we don't have time to discuss this abomination of desolation tonight. But suffice it to say that Jesus spoke about Daniel as a prophet, didn't he? He says Daniel is a true prophet, and he says those people who study Daniel, let them understand. And so Jesus has pronounced a special blessing upon those who will study the book of Daniel. Well, in Daniel chapter 12, and we're going to be looking at several things in Daniel a little bit later, but let's just for a minute turn to Daniel chapter 12. Daniel chapter 12. And I'm going to be reading here just a verse or so. Daniel is one of the major prophets right after Ezekiel. Daniel chapter 12 and verse 4. He says, But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. He says that this book of Daniel was going to be, as it were, sealed until a certain time. And what was that time, according to the text? The time of the end. Now, did I make that up? Is it my idea or my words? No, this is what the prophet had said through inspiration. In fact, it's actually the angel that had come to Daniel, and Daniel recorded it. And he says that at the time of the end, the prophecy is not going to be sealed anymore. That means we're going to be able to understand these prophecies. know how important they are and how to apply them to our lives. Now let's turn to the book of Revelation, another very important book of the Bible, a book of prophecy. Revelation chapter 1, and we're going to begin in verse 1. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 1. We're talking about prophecy tonight and revival. And what does prophecy have to do with Jesus? Well, notice what the very first verse says. It says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. This book of Revelation, it's a revelation not just simply about prophecies and events and things that are to be foretold, but it's a revelation about our Savior, Jesus Christ. He says it's the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass, and he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. And now notice verse 3. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy, and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. And truly today, the time is at hand. And so there's a threefold blessing here. For those who read it, for those who hear it, for those who keep those things that are written therein. So there are actually some things to keep in this book. There's instruction on ways that we should live in this book. And God pronounces a special blessing upon it. And it's no coincidence, friends, that of all the prophetic books of the Bible, the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation are what we today call apocalyptic symbolic prophecies that deal especially with events that are going to occur throughout history all the way down to the end of time, telling us about God's people, events that they will go through, and how they will relate to those events. Now the word prophecy simply means an unfolding or unscrolling or an opening up of understanding that God sends to us. And prophecy, if I'd like to define it for you, if I may, I think the simplest way to define prophecy is to simply say it's history written before it happens. Prophecy is history written before it happens. And so to understand prophecy, to understand fulfilled prophecy, we need to understand history. And so tonight, we're going to be at times looking at some history. Now, I want to begin with just some basic sacred history. In Genesis chapter 11, we're introduced to a man by the name of Abraham. And in Genesis chapter 12, God calls Abraham out of Ur of the Chaldeans. Abraham had to leave that system of Babylon, if you please. And God took him and put him into another place. And Abraham had a son, and his name was Isaac. And Isaac had a son whose name was Jacob. He also had a son named Esau, but we're thinking about the prophetic line here. And Jacob had 12 sons who became what we today call the 12 tribes of Israel. Israel went down to Egypt during a famine when Joseph, one of those sons, had become prime minister of Egypt. They stayed in Egypt, and then God called them out of Egypt. They crossed through the Red Sea. They spent time in the wilderness. And then finally Joshua took them across the swelling Jordan River into the Promised Land. Israel went through the times of the judges, and then the kingdom of Saul, followed by the kingdom of David and his son Solomon. But something happened after that. What happened after Solomon died? The kingdom split in two, didn't it? And so you no longer had a unified nation. You had two different nations now. You had the northern kingdom that was called Israel and the southern kingdom that was called Judah, because Judah was the primary tribe of the southern kingdom. Assyria captured the northern kingdom of Israel in 722 B.C. And then around 605 B.C., Babylon, the nation of Babylon, led by King Nebuchadnezzar, took Judah, including certain of the king's descendants, captive, made them eunuchs, and trained them in the wisdom and the skill of Babylon. And Daniel chapter 1 tells us that Daniel Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah were four of those eunuchs who were trained in the wisdom of Babylon. Now, when they got to Babylon, they changed their names. Do you remember what Daniel's name was? Belteshazzar. And the other three were named Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, right? And they all had pagan, these names had pagan meanings to them. Instead of having the Hebrew names, which signified things about their relationship to God, now they had pagan names. And they could change their names, but friends, they couldn't change their faith. Isn't that right? And you know, there'll be people today in our time and day, and they will say things about us. They'll say things about you. And they will try to deride you. And they may call you names. They may make fun of you for even just being a Christian, friends. People can say things about you. They can change the way people look upon you, maybe. Maybe your reputation is slandered. But one thing no one can take from you is your character. Who you really are, you see. No one can take your faith from you. Now, the book of Daniel is sort of divided in two different ways. And it's not just a first part and a second part. There are stories in the book of Daniel, and there are prophecies in the book of Daniel. As Brother Leon used to like to tell me, that the prophecies tell us what's going to happen, and the stories tell us how to relate to those things that are going to happen. And there's a lot of truth in that. In the first chapter of Daniel, there is a death decree. And I know that the book of Revelation speaks about a time coming when there's going to be a mark. Remember the mark of the beast? You've heard about it. When no man can buy or sell. And it says that anyone who doesn't accept the mark of the beast will be killed. And so there's a death decree, though. If you read the first chapter of Daniel, and there's a death decree in the second chapter of Daniel. We're going to read about it, but there's some other things in chapter 1 that are important for us to know, too. But we'll come back to those at another time. But all the way through, you have these stories, and then you have these prophecies, and they're very important for us to know. But the first actual prophecy is in chapter 2, and so I want to invite you to open your Bibles to Daniel chapter 2, because we're studying about Daniel chapter 2 tonight and the second coming of Jesus. Daniel chapter 2. And we're going to take time to read through most of this chapter tonight. I'd like to welcome these brethren who have come in from very far away, some of them. Brother David Sims from the Philippines, and we have a brother here from Russia, and one from Washington State, is that right?
Yes.
Welcome, brother.
Paul. His name is Paul.
Paul. Yeah, welcome, brother Paul. Thank you for being here. David, you are a strong man to be able to still be standing after all you've been traveling for the last many hours. Daniel chapter 2, starting in verse 1. And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, Nebuchadnezzar dreamed dreams wherewith his spirit was troubled and his sleep brake from him. Then the king commanded to call the magicians and the astrologers and the sorcerers and the Chaldeans for to shew the king his dreams. For so they came and stood before the king. And the king said to them, I have dreamed a dream, and my spirit was troubled to know the dream. Then spake the Chaldeans to the king in Syriac, O king, live forever. Tell thy servants the dream, and we will shew the interpretation. The king answered and said to the Chaldeans, The thing is gone from me. If ye will not make known unto me the dream with the interpretation thereof, ye shall be cut in pieces, and your houses shall be made a dunghill. Let me just pause for a minute. Have you ever had a dream that seemed even vivid at the time you were dreaming, and then you woke up and you could remember just a little bit of it, but in just a few minutes, it's like you just couldn't remember it? We've all had that experience. And this was something like the experience that King Nebuchadnezzar had. But you have to understand, these people, they consider dreams very possibly important at times. And of course, this dream was important because it wasn't just a common dream. It was a supernatural dream, a dream that God had given to this king. And he wanted to know what was going on about it. And so he calls these magicians in. These people who are experts in what we would today call the occult. And he says, you know, you all are so smart. Tell me the dream and tell me the interpretation. And they said, well, if you tell us the dream, we'll tell you the interpretation. And of course, how in the world would the king know if the interpretation was right or not? They could make up any interpretation they wanted. Well, let's read on. Verse 7. Then answered again and said, let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will show the interpretation of it. Verse 8. The king answered and said, I know of certainty that ye would gain the time, because ye see the thing is gone from me. But if you'll not make known unto me the dream, there's but one decree for you. For ye have prepared lying and corrupt words to speak before me, till the time be changed. Therefore, tell me the dream, and I shall know that ye can show me the interpretation thereof. And that makes sense, doesn't it? If I had a dream, and I asked you to tell me the dream and what it meant, if you were able to tell me the dream, I would have pretty good confidence you could tell me what it meant. Verse 10. The Chaldeans answered before the king and said, there is not a man upon the earth that can shew the king's matter. Therefore, there is no king, lord, nor ruler that asked such things at any magician or astrologer or Chaldean. And it is a rare thing that the king requireth, and there is none other that can shew it before the king except the gods whose dwelling is not with flesh. So, who can show this then? Who can show this? Well, keep your hand here in Daniel. We're going to come right back to it. But I want you to turn with me in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 57 and verse 15. Isaiah is just back a little bit toward the front of your Bible, shortly after the book of Psalms. Isaiah 57 and verse 15. Isaiah 57, 15. For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in the high and holy place with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite ones. God says, I am high, I am holy, I am above all, but he says, I will dwell with the humble heart. That's what he says. Well, let's go back to Daniel 2. Daniel chapter 2 and verse 12. For this cause the king was angry and very furious and commanded to destroy all the wise men of Babylon. Here is a death decree. And all these people who professed or at least were categorized as wise men, as these elite of the elites in the intellect, were decreed to be killed. And verse 13, the decree went forth that the wise men should be slain, and they sought Daniel and his fellows to be slain because they had been found to be 10 times wiser than all the wise men in the rest of the realm. And I'll try to speak a little slower. I realize I'm going too fast probably now. Verse 14. Then Daniel answered with counsel and wisdom to Arioch, the captain of the king's guard, which was gone forth to slay the wise men of Babylon. He answered and said to Arioch, the king's captain, why is the decree so hasty from the king? Then Arioch made the thing known to Daniel. Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time and that he would shew the king the interpretation. Then Daniel went into his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, his companions, that they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning this secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Verse 19. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. Daniel answered and said, blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. He changeth the times and the seasons. He removeth kings and setteth up kings. He giveth wisdom unto the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. There's a text in the book of Amos you know well. Amos chapter 3 and verse 7. The Lord God will do what? Nothing except what happens. He reveals it unto his servants, the prophets. God wasn't going to do this until also it had been revealed to one of his prophets. And so he revealed this dream and all that was happening about it to Daniel. Excuse me. Thank you. And let's read on, verse 22 now. He says, that God revealeth the deep and secret things. He knoweth what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. I thank thee and praise thee, O thou God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might, and has made known unto me now what we desire of thee, for thou hast now made known unto us the king's matter. Going on in verse 24. Then Daniel went in to Arioch, whom the king had ordained to destroy the wise men of Babylon. He went in and said thus unto him, destroy not the wise men of Babylon. Bring me in before the king, and I will shew unto the king the interpretation. Then Arioch brought in Daniel before the king in haste, and said thus unto him, I have found a man of the captives of Judah, and they will make known unto the king the interpretation. And the king asked him, he says, can you really do this? And Daniel answered in the presence of the king, I mean, verse 27 now, the secret which the king hath demanded, cannot the wise men, the astrologers, the magicians, the soothsayers, shew unto the king? And I'd like to say now these next words in your Bible, in verse 28, are some of the most sublime words of all the Bible. But there is a God in heaven. We live in a secular world, a world that is increasingly becoming more and more secular. Belief in God is diminishing more and more all the time. And I think that this text has an appropriate place in our understanding tonight, that there is a God in heaven. Not just anyone, there's a God in heaven. And the Bible says that He is the one who rules over everything. And this God in heaven reveals secrets and makes known unto the king Nebuchadnezzar what shall be in the latter days. Thy dream and the visions of thy head upon thy bed are these. And now Daniel's going to explain the dream to him. Tell him what he saw. As for thee, O king, thy thoughts came into thy mind upon thy bed. What should come to pass hereafter? And he that reveals secrets make known to thee what shall come to pass. You know, it's interesting. Daniel wanted to know what this dream was. And he wanted to know what the interpretation was. But God gave him a little extra. Did you see it? God gave him some extra. Because not only did Daniel know the dream and the interpretation, but he knew what Nebuchadnezzar was thinking before he went to sleep. What was on his mind before he went to sleep. And he's thinking, you know, I've built this great Babylon. What happens after me? Verse 30. Daniel says, but as for me, this secret is not revealed to me for any wisdom that I have more than any living, but for their sake that shall make known the interpretation to the king, and that thou mightest know the thoughts of thy heart. And now notice the humble spirit that Daniel has, that same humble spirit that we read about in Isaiah 57, 15. This is why God could reveal to Daniel and not to others. And so the dream, verse 31 through 35, tells us about the dream. It says, behold, he says, thou, O king, sawest and behold a great image. The great image whose brightness was excellent stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken into pieces together, and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. And I'm going to skip ahead a slide here extra. And this is something like the image that Nebuchadnezzar saw in his dream. This image had a head of gold. It had a chest and arms of silver. It had a midsection of, it says brass in the King James. Some translations say bronze. The actual Hebrew word simply means a red metal. most likely copper. Bronze and brass are both alloys made from copper, but actually, historically, at the time of this vision, brass had not been invented yet. So it was most likely bronze or just simply copper. And then it had legs of iron and feet of iron and clay, and there was a stone that came, and we'll talk about that stone a little bit more in a little bit later. So let's read now a little bit about the interpretation starting in verse 36. So we have an understanding of the basic idea of what this king saw, but we need to understand what does this all mean now. Because if I just saw something like this in a dream, I don't know about you, but I'd be pretty lost to try to figure out what significance it could have. How could that apply? But friends, God knows everything, doesn't he? And he knows how to teach us. Well, verse 36. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king. Verse 37. Thou, O king, he's speaking, now this is Daniel speaking to Nebuchadnezzar. He says, Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, strength, and glory. Let me just pause. You remember we read earlier in this chapter when Daniel and his companions received the dream that they say, you know, blessed be the name of God. You set up kings, you take down kings. And he's telling that to the king Nebuchadnezzar here. Thou, O king, art a king of kings, for the God of heaven hath given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. And whereas the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of heaven hath he given unto thine hand, and hath made thee ruler over them all. Thou art this head of gold. Nebuchadnezzar, you, your kingdom, together, you represent this head of gold. That probably made him feel pretty good. Nebuchadnezzar probably enjoyed hearing that. And I suppose if we had lived in Babylon at that time, we might have thought that sounds pretty good. Because what was Babylon like? Well, we know that one of the ancient wonders of the world were the Hanging Gardens of Babylon. And although some of the historical accounts vary, and it may be hard to gauge the accuracy of them all, some accounts say that the city of Babylon was up to 15 miles square, walls that extended up possibly as high as 200 or 300 feet, and wide enough for chariots to race around. While some of these accounts, again, may have been exaggerated, there's little doubt that with its hanging gardens, with its famous Esther Gate, and here's, by the way, a reproduction of it, I think, in the Berlin Museum, what it might have looked like. But with these beautiful things, these breathtaking grandeur that it possessed, Babylon was a city and a nation of gold, and gold was a fit symbol to represent Babylon. But now, Daniel is not finished interpreting the dream. In verse 39, he must tell the king what will be sad news to the king. And after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be as strong as iron, for as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these, and shall break in pieces and bruise. He said that Babylon is going to fall, and there's going to be a succession of kingdoms coming after it. And in fact, God had prophesied through Isaiah that Babylon indeed was going to fall. If we would turn to Isaiah 13, again, keep your hand in Daniel. We'll be coming right back to it. Daniel 2, if you have a marker there, just lay it right in. But let's go back to Isaiah 13, if we could. And we're going to read verses 19 through 21. Isaiah 13, verses 19 through 21. And Babylon, the glory of kingdoms, the beauty of the Chaldees, excellently shall be as when God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. It shall never be inhabited, neither shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation, neither shall the Arabian pitch tent there, neither shall the shepherds make their fold there, but wild beasts of the desert shall lie there, and their houses shall be full of doleful creatures, and owls shall dwell there, and satyrs shall dance there. Wow. This sounds bad. This sounds like the most glorious city that the world had ever seen up to that point is going to become so desolate that there won't be anything left there the doleful creatures. But friends, God means exactly what He says. I want to just share, I'm going to skip back a couple slides for the ones running our slides here to slide number 3. A Bible writer wrote about this dream and they made this comment and I thought it was nice. Though this wonderful dream caused a marked change to take place in the ideas and opinions of King Nebuchadnezzar, his soul was not cleansed from its pride, its worldly ambition, its desire for self-exaltation by the converting power of God. The rise and fall of the kingdoms which were to succeed Babylon were minutely described to him by the prophet. But instead of treasuring the conviction which had been made on his mind in regard to the fall of all earthly kingdoms and the greatness and power of Jehovah's kingdom, the king, after the immediate impression wore away, thought only of his own greatness and studied how he might make the dream turn to his own exaltation and honor. You've all seen something like this. Someone is presented with the claims of the gospel. And they're under conviction, and they know they need to make changes in their lives. They know they need to repent. They know they need to change their ways. And they think about it for a little while, but they don't act immediately upon it. And when they don't act immediately upon it, that thought becomes a little weaker and a little weaker. And before long, it's banned from their minds even. And this is what happened to King Nebuchadnezzar. And it's a lesson book to us, friends. It's a lesson book that when God sends conviction, don't wait around. Don't wait around. Do what is right because it is right, friends. Leave the consequences to God. Nebuchadnezzar didn't want to believe that his kingdom would not last forever. And if we could just flip forward to a couple slides more here, to slide number, whatever number that happens to be after that. Don't have the number on this one, but in Daniel chapter 3, there's a story. Remember I said that Daniel is a book that has prophecies and stories in it? And here's a story that actually has another death decree in it. Nebuchadnezzar thought about this great image. And he said, you know, I'm that head of gold, but I will be that whole image. And instead of my kingdom going away for another kingdom, my kingdom will last forever. And so they erected this great image in the plain of Dura there that was about 90 feet tall. And it was made of solid gold. And Nebuchadnezzar, he said, now everybody come together. And the Bible says that if you can read it in Daniel 3, we don't have time to read it all tonight. But that all the leaders from his provinces came. And that would have included the vassal king from Judah. And they were commanded to bow down and to worship this image when they played the music. And there were 3 men who would not bow down and worship this image. And you remember who they were? Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. And they would not bow down. And God blessed them because their hearts were humble. And we today sometimes even refer to them as the 3 Hebrew worthies. Well, God wasn't through dealing with Nebuchadnezzar. In chapter 4 of Daniel, you read about a problem that Nebuchadnezzar had, a problem of pride and how he was humbled and abased and finally exalted the God of heaven. And he died. He died. But then his son and grandson became rulers of Babylon. And in chapter 5 of Daniel, if we could go back to the book of Daniel, we're getting some of the history, not only from historical sources, but from sacred sources, because the book has some of the history in it here. In Daniel chapter 5, it says, Belshazzar, the king, made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the Lord. Now, who was Belshazzar?
Grandson.
He was the grandson of Nebuchadnezzar. Sometimes he's spoken of as a son of Nebuchadnezzar, and Nebuchadnezzar was his father, but this was the way Babel language was in those times. His father's name was Evo-Merodach, and this now his son is Belshazzar. And Belshazzar, while he tasted the wine, and by the way, in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 1, it says, wine is a what? Mocker, and strong drink is raging, and who is deceived thereby is not wise. This man was not wise, was he? While he tasted the wine, he commanded to bring the golden and silver vessels which his father Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple, which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines might drink thereof. When Nebuchadnezzar took Jerusalem and ransacked the temple. And all those golden instruments, they took them back to Babylon. And according to Ezra, I think there were about 5,400 of them. It was no small stash. And so they say, look, we're going to praise our gods. Because after all, we are in this great city. It is, as it were, an impregnable fortress. If you have walls that are 15, 20 feet, maybe thicker, you just don't get through those very easy before you have cannons. You know, there's no artillery like cannons in these days. There's no bombs to put on those kind of walls that can begin to phase them. They have the river Euphrates running through the middle of the city. They have a constant water supply. They have plenty of room to grow their food. I'm sure it was non-GMO, Elvis. They had seemingly no worries in the world. Even though Cyrus the Persian is waiting outside. Verse 3. Then they brought the golden vessels that were taken out of the temple of the house of God, which was at Jerusalem, and the king and his princes and his wives and his concubines drank in them. That was blasphemous. They drank wine and praised the gods of gold and of silver and of brass, of iron, of wood, and of stone. And in the same hour, they're having this great debauchery. And in the same hour, there came forth the fingers of a man's hand and wrote over against the candlestick upon the plaster of the wall of the king's palace, and the king saw the part of the hand that wrote. What would it do to you? What would it do to your countenance if you were in this kind of a drunken spell and all of a sudden you see a bloodless hand appear writing upon the wall? I think it would get your attention quickly, and it got his attention very quickly, Belshazzar's attention. Verse 6, then the king's countenance was changed, and his thoughts troubled him, so that the joints of his loins were loosed, and his knees smote one against another. In other words, he was so scared, his knees were knocking against each other. And friends, I want to tell you, when God causes men to fear, they cannot hide their fear. Today, very many men are bold in their iniquity and brazen in their sin. But when God causes men to fear, they cannot hide it. Verse 7, the king cried aloud to bring in the astrologers. Remember what his grandfather did when he had a dream? Get all the astrologers, the soothsayers. That's what he did. None of them could read this writing on the wall. They didn't understand what it meant. They couldn't interpret it. But he called in Daniel, and Daniel could. And in verse 23, Daniel 5:23. Well, I'll read verse 22. After Daniel refreshing Belshazzar's memory about his grandfather, he said unto him in verse 22, and thou, his son, O Belshazzar, hast not humbled thy heart, though thou knewest all this. These events were not hidden, chronicled away in a lockbox somewhere. He knew the history of his grandfather. He knew how he had been humbled and brought to the point of God. And friends, sometimes we know sacred truth. We know sacred truth, but we don't do better. Verse 23, even though he knew all that, he says, but thou hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven, and they have brought the vessels of his house before thee. And thou and thy lords, thy wives, and thy concubines have drunk wine in them. And thou hast praised the gods of silver and gold, of brass, iron, wood, and stone, which see not, nor hear, nor know, and the God in whose hand thy breath is, and whose are all thy ways, hast thou not glorified. And then he told him the writing, meeni, meeni, tekel, upharsin. And he said that this means that you are weighed in the balances and found wanting, and that the kingdom is given to the Medes and the Persians. And that's exactly what happened. And in fact, if you remember, we said that Babylon was foretold in Isaiah to be destroyed and be uninhabited, right? What chapter was that in Isaiah? 13. Isaiah 13. But let's look at another chapter in Isaiah, Isaiah 45 now. Keeping your hand here in Daniel again. Isaiah 45. Isaiah 45. Verse 1. Isaiah 45, verse 1. Thus saith the Lord to his anointed, to who? Cyrus, whose right hand I have holden to subdue nations before him. And I will loose the loins of kings to open before him the two-leaved gates, and the gates shall not be shut. He says, this man is going to make the loins of kings shake. And you know what happened that night that we just read about. And he says that there's going to be a two-leaved gate that's going to open up. I'm going to open this, and it's not going to get shut. And we could look at some more. Let's look at some more. Isaiah 44, 27, just back a few verses. That thou sayest to the deep, be dry, and I will dry up thy river. Verse 28. That saith Osiris, he is my shepherd, and shall perform all my pleasure, even saying to Jerusalem, thou shalt be built, and to the temple thy foundation shall be laid. And we could read more in Jeremiah, if we could. Jeremiah 50. Jeremiah 50, and we'll read verses 35 and 38. Jeremiah 50, 35 and 38. It says, a sword is upon the Chaldeans, saith the Lord, and upon the inhabitants of Babylon, and upon her princes, and upon her wise men. A drought is upon her waters, and they shall be dried up, for it is the land of graven images, and they are mad upon their idols. We know that history tells us that in the year 538 B.C., that Cyrus the Persian had his soldiers build an artificial lake, and they channeled the water from the Euphrates River into this artificial lake. And the idea was they could not go through the walls, but if we could eliminate the river, at least temporarily, we could go under the in through the channel of the river, under those gates, and into the city. And this is exactly what they were going to do. But you know what happened when they got there? They found the gates were opened. The gates were open just exactly as God said that they would be. And so Cyrus the Persian conquered Babylon, but according to Daniel 5:31, he let his uncle Darius the Mede rule in his stead. And this alliance of the Medes and the Persians were that second empire that came then after Babylon. But if you remember in Daniel chapter 2, it said that there would be another kingdom that would come after that one, and it would be inferior. And that seems strange because the Medes and Persians were actually stronger than the Babylonians. But silver is inferior to gold, and especially in their moral condition. They were even more morally bankrupt than the Babylonians. And this is true as we go down through this metallic man. So the head of gold, the chest and arms of silver, but there was another nation to come. And the nation that conquered the Persians, you know, was the Greeks with Alexander the Great, with his army of bronze shields, swords, helmets, and armor that came upon the scene. And in 331 BC, at the Battle of Arbela, Alexander defeated Darius III, and he ended the Persian rule, which had lasted for more than 200 years. Three of these great kingdoms. But there's a fourth kingdom. Let's go back to Daniel 2 quickly. Daniel chapter 2. And verse 40. Daniel chapter 2 and verse 40. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as what?
Iron.
For as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these shall it break in pieces and bruise. In 168 BC, Rome became the dominant world power. And, you know, Rome, sometimes has even been described as the Iron Monarchy of Rome. Here we see a picture of, as it is today, the Colosseum in Rome. But Rome was a magnificent empire in its day. We can't begin to understand all that was involved in its grandeur that they had. But it was iron. It was stronger militarily than the Greeks, but it was not nearly as valuable in sense of morality. Their morality was even lower than the Greeks. Now, in Daniel 2, again, verse 41, we find the last part of the prophecy. And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided, but there shall be in it of the strength of the iron, for as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay. And as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. When the Roman Empire broke up in AD 476, it broke up into 10 different divisions. And you probably remember studying some of these in history. But just like iron and clay, you have some strong, you have some weak. History tells us that Rome was divided into 10 kingdoms, the Heruli, the Vandals, the Ostrogoths, the Anglo-Saxons that became England, the Franks that became the French, the Alemanni of Germany, the Visigoths of Spain, the Suevi of Portugal, and the Lombards of Italy with the Burgundians of what we today call Switzerland. And it's interesting, and there's a prophecy I think Brother Simps may direct our attention to in a few nights that deals specifically with three of these kingdoms, the Heruli, the Ostrogoths, and the Vandals, that they were uprooted. And they were uprooted because they would not go along with the Antichrist power. Now the text says that they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. And they intermarried to bring about unity. These different kings and queens would give their sons and their daughters to other kings and queens, sons and daughters, to try to bring about a unity and alliance. But the text says that they shall not cleave one to another. And many tried to bring about a unity throughout history. Rulers such as Charlemagne, Charles V of Spain, Louis XIV of France, Napoleon, Kaiser Wilhelm. In fact, Kaiser Wilhelm II, it's interesting that there used to be at the cathedral in Metz, Germany, there was a statue of the prophet Daniel. But the Kaiser knew about this prophecy, and he was planning to have a world empire. And he actually had the head of Daniel cut off the statue and his own head put on it. No doubt, he said to himself, I too am an emperor. I too have a dream. I will unite all of Europe into one empire. I will be my own prophet. The Kaiser then invaded France, but the words of Daniel still held. The Kaiser failed. Hitler came and tried, and he failed. The European Union has tried to form a quasi-league, but with Brexit, we see even this partial union system in failure today. So what was going to happen now? Daniel 2:44. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom, which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand how long?
Forever.
Verse 45. For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hands, and that it brake in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the great God hath made known to the king what shall come to pass thereafter. And the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof is sure. Beloved, Jesus is coming back soon. This stone, Jesus is represented by a stone. In fact, if we could look at 1 Peter 2:6 in the New Testament, over near the end of the New Testament, 1 Peter 2:6, right after Hebrews, James, and then you have Peter. 1 Peter 2:6. It says, wherefore also it is contained in the Scripture, behold, I lay in Sion a chief cornerstone, elect precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. He says, this is in the Scriptures. And it was in Isaiah chapter 28 and verse 16. These very words that Peter are quoting from. And it calls Jesus this great chief cornerstone. In Ephesians chapter 2, if we could turn there, Ephesians chapter 2. Right after Galatians, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 and 20. Paul says, now therefore ye are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God, and are built upon the foundation, the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being what? The chief cornerstone. I like that, don't you, friends? I like that. In these days, the kingdoms the kingdom of Christ will surely come. And in Revelation chapter 19, it says that Jesus is not coming again as a lowly servant, but he's going to come as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, Jesus today, friends, and this is important, Jesus today is establishing a kingdom. But it's a kingdom of what we might call grace. Because we don't have a nation that we live under. We don't have a visible king in Jesus here on this earth today. But if you would turn with me to Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 16, please. Hebrews 4, 16. He tells us what we may do. Hebrews 4, 16. He says, let us therefore come boldly unto the what? Throne of grace. Who sits upon a throne? King does. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Today, Jesus is establishing a kingdom of grace, and when he comes the second time without sin and the salvation, he's going to establish a king of glory. Daniel said that the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof is certain. I think of what the thief on the cross said to Jesus. He simply asked him, Lord, remember me when thou what? Comest in thy kingdom. The signs of the times tell us, beloved, that the coming of Jesus is very soon. The prophecies about these great world empires, they've all been fulfilled. We're right down at the very end of this prophecy, friends. And Jesus is coming. He is that great stone, and he and his kingdom is going to destroy all these other kingdoms. And he's going to set up a kingdom that will last forever, and he wants you to be a part of it. All you have to do is say, Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. Amen. That's what he wants you to do tonight. If we could turn to Matthew chapter 25. Matthew 25 and verse 34. Matthew 25, 34. Jesus has taught a parable about sheep and goats, about right hand, left hand, who's in, who's out. It says, then shall the king say unto them on the right hand, come ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Brother Robert over here is wanting to build a house soon. He's been making plans to do that. Got to get the land first. Coming soon, hopefully. But he's making plans. He's making plans. Do you know that God has made plans for a kingdom before this world even began? And part of those plans, including having you there, Rhonda, having me there, Sister Jillian, having you there, every one of us being in that kingdom. And he said, all we have to do is we come and inherit it. Because, friends, when we come and we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, the Bible says that he is our elder brother and that we become heirs and joint heirs with Christ. Joint heirs with Christ. And when you're a joint heir, you get to inherit. And I get to inherit just like Jesus does. And I like that idea. I do. Well, in Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12. Verse 31. Jesus has been speaking about things of this world, about the ravens. He's speaking about the lilies and how God cares for the ravens. He cares for the sparrows. He cares for the lilies even. And then he says in verse 30, for all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that ye have need of these things. But rather seek ye what? The kingdom of God. And all these things shall be added unto you. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's what? Good pleasure to do what? To give unto you the kingdom. friends, tonight, if you would like to say in your heart, Lord, remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom, would you stand at this time and say to the Lord, yes, by my standing, I want you to remember me when you come in your kingdom. If that's your desire, I'd like to invite you to stand tonight. God is good, isn't he?
Yes, he is.
Oh, he's so good. We're going to have, please sit down. Please sit down for a second. God sees you and he appreciates you. But we're going to have a special selection before we have closing prayer. And this song is a beautiful song that Brother and Sister McQuills are going to share. And so we're going to ask them to come up at this time. And I believe they'll be accompanied by Brother Caleb.
Thou my everlasting portion, more than friend or life to me. All along my pilgrim journey, Savior, let me walk with thee. Come to thee, close to thee. All along my pilgrim journey, Savior, let me walk with thee. Not for ease or worldly pleasure, not for fame my prayer shall be. Gladly will I toil and suffer, only let me walk with thee. Close to thee, close to thee, close to thee, close to thee. Gladly will I toil and suffer, only let me walk with thee. Shadows bear me o'er life's fitful sea. Then the great of life eternal, may I enter, Lord, with thee. Close to thee, close to thee, close to thee, close to thee. Then the gate of life eternal, may I enter, Lord, with thee.
Amen.
Thank you, Mac and Sandy. I appreciate that greatly. That's beautifully sung and meaningful words. I'd like to say that tomorrow night you'll have a much better preacher up here, and he's going to share with you some very important things from Daniel. I'm really just filling in because he was not going to be able to be here in time tonight for him. So we're looking forward to Pastor Sims sharing tomorrow night. But friends, be here tomorrow night. We'll be starting again same time tomorrow night. And these are important truths that we need to know. I mean, maybe you've studied some of these things before, and I'm just going to read you a verse in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 1. That says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord to write the same things to you. To me, indeed, it is not grievous, but for you, it is safe. Maybe you've studied some of these things before, but you've got things to learn yet, and you've got things to be reinforced in yet. And we all want to be remembered by the Lord when he comes in his kingdom. We want to be ready. And we can't
Beloved, we can't depend upon the experience we had yesterday or last week or last year. We can only depend upon the experience that we're having right now. And God is able to do this for us, isn't he? He's able to do it. I'd like to invite you to, where possible, kneel or bow your heads as we have a closing prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the blessing of your word, for the great prophecy of Daniel. And Jesus has told us that if we will study it, that we'll be blessed. And as we especially connect it with Revelation and these great truths that you have for your people in these last days, we want to be ready when Jesus comes in his kingdom, Father. So please, please help us to surrender our hearts, to be submissive to your will, to realize that without Jesus, we have no hope. But through Jesus, we can have forgiveness of sins. We can be part of the family of God. We can be heirs and joint heirs with Christ. So please bring us all back again tomorrow evening, and bring many more too, Father. And may your word be exalted. May you be glorified. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.